Ladies and gentlemen, we're not too far away from Alan arriving, but please enjoy the sounds that are on for your pleasure. DJ Polo, available for 21st. Help yourself. So Alan's still making his way. What's going to happen? We're going to get a haka of Tongaro College. And then we'll start the program. Thank you.
When life was so much simpler. Oh, oh yeah, yeah. Oh yeah, oh, oh, oh yeah, yeah. I didn't have a lot of things and life wasn't much, but we sure had some fun. The joy and the pain and the laughter. Oh,
oh yeah, yeah. Oh yeah,
that's right.
Oh, oh, oh yeah, yeah.
I gotta make you wish that we were still in love, love, love. So
what? What I'm trying to say to you is that I'm still in love with you, and I want a second try.
Purify my heart, sanctify my soul. Talofalava, everyone. Just want to welcome everybody here as we lay Ellen to rest this day. Look, my name is Te Omalu, the Matai name from my father's village from Sakui Malufilufi. Maitia, the name of my wife's father's village in Lalumangu. Junior, because I carry my father's Samoan name. Junior isn't actually even part of my real name, but everybody know me as Junior. Most people, a lot of people that have that know me also know me as Patrick. But for me, I'm Alan's little brother. So welcome all. So good to see everybody here this morning. What we're going to do is, as we move through the program, we're going to have a song. If I can get everybody just to take a seat, please. And I'll hand it over to Wills.
Ngā mihi nui tēnei ki a koe e te rangatira ko tai mai, nau mai, haru mai. Family, Alice wanted us to sing worship this morning. And listen, if you've never worshipped before, it's an incredible experience. I can remember walking into the PIC church as a Māori boy. And it wasn't for God, I was looking for my wife. And but I remember them sitting and the incredible harmonies that came from that place, the beautiful PIC. They used to call it the sleeping giant because of the potential that came from that place. There's a revival happening. There's a revival happening. So as we sing this song, don't even look at the person next to you. The song is being sung to the Lord. This guy here would always point us. So if anything was directed his way, he would deflect it and point us. To the one. I think we might have some words this morning as well. We don't have words. So if you have a phone, beautiful. If you have a phone, make sure it's on silent first. And then you can look up the word for the song. Mountains about the land and the seas, the sound of your name. I support your hands, all of your hands, forever I love you, forever I stand. Thank you.
Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. 'Cause you're my shelter and you're my comfort. You're my tower of refuge and strength. And let every breath and all that I am, yes, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, let's go. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King, yes. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the works of your hands, yes. Nothing compares to the promise. I shout to the Lord. Oh, shout
to the Lord of the earth. Let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar.
Hey, I'll just open us up in a word of prayer. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness. And we thank you, Lord, that you are sovereign and that you are good in every way. And Lord, we commit this time together. We thank you, Father God, for Alan and for the life he's lived. But we thank you, Father God, that you are king of his life. And Lord, we commit everyone that's here this morning. We thank you for those that are sort of streaming in and participating in today's service. But we give you thanks. We give you glory. We honor you for all things. And we just want to say how wonderful you are. And we bless you this morning. In the precious name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Hi, everyone. With also Alan, and a lot of you would know is that Alan was the king of putting people on the spot, and a lot of you may have experienced that, and I've experienced that all my life, and so even with welcoming you all this morning. It's been my privilege to be here and to say welcome. Haere mai a whiu mai, and welcome this morning. Look, praise the Lord, my son and I made it. We're currently in the Gold Coast at the moment, and it's been a mission for us to get here to farewell my brother. I want to acknowledge a few people because there are just so many people that Alan's reach has touched, and there are family over in Australia that rallied around us to get our, as we were trying to get here. We would be watching, my son Amos and I were watching the live stream. My wife would go live, so we knew what was happening back here in New Zealand with Alan's passing. And as much as we were blessed to see everybody coming, and you know, just amazed at what we were seeing in regards to people talking about the impact Alan made on their lives, it was breaking us being over there. And there are a lot of family over there, and I want to acknowledge my Auntie Kiki and Uncle Peter, my Grey family, and my cousins Andrew, Stacey, Bucky, and Peter and their families, and also my cousins, the Wapos, Bevy and Moa, and our Leo family, and all the other people that touched base with us while we were there, just to send us support and that. Like, there's just so many people. But I've got the privilege of just talking about my relationship with my brother. And last night I was jotting down a few things just in regards to my bro and our relationship. And as usual, my wife was critiquing me about my ums and ahs, because I'm a ama and an ara when I speak, so I'm not the I'm not the best speaker, but I just want to bless bless you all by telling you about how wonderful my brother was. Growing up with Alan, there's five of us. We have our brother Lae that came over from Samoa when we were very young, and he took that older brother mantle. And then we had Alan, my birth brothers and sisters. Alan was the oldest of them, and Alan, there's a 2-year gap between Alan and my older sister Gina. So Alan's 2 years older than Gina, and Gina's 2 years older than me. So Anne Marie's 4 years younger than me. So I'll just leave that with you, and you guys figure that out. I think we were first three were playing. Nah. But no, Marie's our baby, and but she's also our baby. It's like, be honest. But I just want to say that when Alan was an awesome brother. And I remember Alan had a giving. He had that in him at a very young age. When Alan was in Form 4, I think my older sister Gina touched on this. Alan left school because it was only my dad working, and my dad was struggling to pay all the bills, and that's so Alan asked my dad if he could leave school, and so he could help dad. So Alan left school, and at the age of 15, 16, and he went to work at Fish and Pockle, and he worked with my dad, and he basically put my sisters and I through school. So Alan was made a lot of sacrifices. But in the long run, Alan's the only one that has a tertiary qualification out of the four of us. Go figure, eh? So my brother, he did so many things for us. And I remember Alan used to love dressing up, and I think he used to do that to impress Ellie and And so he used to go into town, and he would go down to Vulcan Lane, was it? There used to be this place, Canterbury Arcade, and there used to be this place that had the latest clothes. A lot of Alan's friends, Gwana and them would know, and Willie, and he would go buy the latest clothes so he could look wonderful. And he would take me with him sometimes, and he would buy me stuff. And Alan would do that. He would I think he used to go dress with Noah, and that when they were back in those Fisherman Pocket days. So he would do those things, and he would. I was the only one. I never got pocket money from my parents because there just wasn't. But Alan would always give me $20 a week or something like that. And back in those days, I was a rich man at school. So Alan looked after me so much. And I know that, Alan did so many things for me, but I think the most precious thing and the most wonderful thing that I hold on to is that Alan had an encounter with God, and he became a follower of Jesus when he was like in his early 20s, him and Alice. And he shared that gift with me. And he told me about Jesus, and I was a stubborn 17, 18 year old that said, used to say to the brother, look, thank you, but you keep that and I'll just carry on doing my own thing. But he was persistent. And some mornings I would wake up and I would see him standing over my bed praying over me. And I would pretend to sleep, and I could hear him going, Lord, save my evil brother. but he would be praying for me, and he would be praying for my salvation as I slept. And that's the most precious thing and legacy that I hold on to my brother about. That my brother, at that age, he was still growing in his relationship with Jesus, that he fell in love with the Lord, and the gospel became everything to him. And I suppose even in the later years, it became even more so to him, and the importance that everybody would have an opportunity to hear it. I know Alan, I'm Alan's only blood brother, but Alan had so many other brothers, and I want to acknowledge them. The boys he grew up with, the old Catholic boys that we all grew up with, are still walking with Alan today, and some have flown in from all over the place, from Australia. Our PIC brothers that we connected with back in the day through Alan Nellis, I heard that people were saying that, why did you Catholic boys come and take all our PIC women? I married a PIC woman too, but it's because you PIC guys are ugly. and I know Alan had so many, he's got so many brothers, and he's got so many people that looked at him as a father figure. So many people over many generations that Alan have touched. But there's Alan has a close, tight-knit group that he goes to when he wants to share the things that are on his heart. And I can see a number. I can see you here today. I was quite fortunate that Alan used to want to include me in the things that he was doing, even though I had no interest in some of these things. But Alan at times felt that he needed his brother there. So he would contact me, and he would share his heart with me. And he would say, are you in, bro? And most of the time, I could never say no to Alan. Even though we argued about different things, I could never say no to him. But that's, it was almost like Alan wanted to take his little brother along with him too, as he did these things. So, sorry guys, I'll... And I remember sometimes Alan and I would swap cars because I think I needed Alan's car at times because he had a big, his car was bigger and I had to do things. And I remember sometimes driving through Otara and in his car, and there were times I drove past Tangaroa College or Hillary College after school started, at the end of school, sorry. And as I was driving past, all these kids' hands would wave at the car, like they, it was Alan. So I just, so after a while, I just started beeping the horn and waving back. but Alan's reach was not only to, his reach was to, from generation to generation. And even though Alan was getting on in years, he was still had a heart and a reach out to young people. I know with my family, my siblings and Alice's siblings, as well as our cousins who we count as, who we regard as siblings, they're like our brothers and sisters. We all loved, everyone loved Alan so dearly and Alan loved him back. And I know how much it meant, how much he meant to my sons, Samuel and Amos. He was, Alan had the ability to, I've heard it so many times, to give someone his full attention, even though things were happening right around you and there. But I just want to say how proud I am of my nephew Caleb and my niece Gloria, and also how blessed I am and of my sister Alice's strength. We hear all the, Alan had many accolades for the work that he did with youth and the work he did in the community. But I think the most important thing for Alan was his relationship with Jesus. And I know talking to him in the later years, the importance of the gospel. And I've been blessed to see Caleb. Everybody that's come to pay their respects, and that Caleb has shared the goodness of Jesus to people as they've come through those doors. And he's told people, you know, he's talked to people around the gospel, and the gospel is that for God so, John 3:16, everyone knows their verse, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. And that was so important to Alan, that people would hear that we need to have a relationship with Jesus. That all of us are sinners, we've all sinned, and that's what separates us from God. And because God is a perfect God, and he cannot look at sin, so he sent his only begotten son, Jesus, so that he would die a horrible death on the cross. That would give us an opportunity, if we followed him and accepted him, to be reconnected to the Father. So Alan was, he loved the gospel message so much, and he would want people to hear the goodness of Jesus and how Jesus wants to, and to touch your life. I remember, in closing, I remember the song, and you know, that we used to sing, and it was when I first became a Christian when I was 18, and I first decided to follow Christ when I was 18, and been some ups and downs, but I made a conscious decision to follow Christ when I was that age. And there was a song by Andre Crouch, and it was called We Are Not Ashamed of the Gospel. Now, I'm not the best singer, but I'm going to try and sing a chorus, and the chorus in that song. When I sing, Alan had a hear that Barry White voice they used to sing. My sisters sing like angels. Marie, she thinks she's a choir conductor, and my sister Gina has such a beautiful voice. And when they used to get me to sing with them, they used to just say, move your mouth, bro, but don't, you know, don't spoil our harmonies. And the song, please help me out with, and it goes, we are not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is God's power of salvation to everyone that believes it. Oh, to everyone that receives it, he shall have everlasting life. Fifth, I love it.
Hello, sorry, my voice is a little bit scratchy at the moment, but I'll try my best. Tōna whalawa, o lau ingoa o te kia malanga whaulo ki ngi e valu. Ua ua le ulu mātua o whanau a Logan, ma Gloria e valu. Ma ua u fōi o le ulu mātua o whanau a whanau o malanga o ma Alan, ma Alice, wa'a. E a vea au, e whai mā sui mō wau uso of Abison, Sayan, Ar, Tobias Legend, mā lau tua whawhine tō tasi o Mavo. Whā mā lulu atu o le whā Peretania no umoni mau. Hello, my name is Shakira Evalu. I'm eldest son of Logan and Gloria, and I'm eldest grandson of our eldest grandson of Alan and Alice. Sorry, I'm not as good a speaker as my papa was, but my papa was a massive role model, not only to me, but to many others in the community. I'm glad that he was able to affect those who he was able to. He loved me so much. I'm glad that I was able to spend so much time with him. He will come to check on me all the time, even after he had just grounded me for doing something stupid. He loved me regardless, even when I didn't pick up his calls. Forgot to grab his rari sachets from the kitchen. thanks. He loved the Lord so much. He would practice reading the scripture every day. The Bible states, to love the Lord, your God, with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. I feel like my papa was the living embodiment of that. He loved everyone so much. He was so selfless that he would put himself in front of others all the time. He was always able to keep the main thing, and that allowed him to connect with so many people, and that allowed him to be loved by so many people. I'm so glad that I was able to help my Uncle Caleb dress him before we sent him off to the hospital. And I'm so glad that I was able to spend the whole day with him before he passed earlier that morning. Oh. I'm grateful for him, and I'm just really glad that his last words he said to me while fully conscious was, "Thank you, grandson." I didn't deserve your praise, Papa. I couldn't even pick up the phone to listen to you ask for your sisters, even though you're in the room right next to me. In closing, I'd just like to share a story. When me and Amos were playing under 13s, my papa was our manager, and the boys who played with us would know this, but at the end of one of our contact drills, I decided to run it straight to Caleb, who was our coach at the time. And after these few steps, all you would hear was, "Papa! Papa! I can't see!" And it was me, lying on the floor with tears in my eyes. So, yeah. Oh, yeah, sorry, that was a stink story. Yeah, but after that, I rejoined training, and then all you could hear is this high-pitched laugh. So, yeah, that added to the stink story. But yeah, so though his mocks were hard, they were bearable, and they'll brighten up your day even after they just stabbed you. So, there are other many things I'd love to tell you about my papa. But he always taught me to keep things short and simple and to make sure the main thing is the main thing. So he loved me and my family so much that it hurt, but we are glad that he has a new set of legs. Yeah. Sorry, I don't know.
Hi family, I'm just gonna share a scripture real quick. So it's Psalms chapter 23, verse 1-6. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Yep. That's it.
I will lift my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made it heaven and earth. I will lift my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. Talofalava. My name is Caleb Benjamin Faifaeseva'a. And I know for a lot of you that have come to the house to pay your respect to Dad, this is the same story that I shared with you, so please bear with me. But my name is Caleb Benjamin Faifaeseva'a. I say that twice because I'm so proud of who I am. I am the proudest and only son of Alan and Alice Va'a. I am the product of two wonderful parents, and I continue to praise the Lord for the wonderful opportunity to do life with them. As the sun beamed down on us, constant reminder, hey, from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the name of the Lord is to be praised. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the name of the Lord is to be praised. As broken as I am, I come before you, Lord. And I praise the King of Kings for blessing us all, not just me, not just Gloria, my mom, blessing us all by working through my dad. And I praise the Lord for so many people have personal relationships with Jesus because of the work that my dad did. I will normally speak from the heart when it comes to things like this, but my dad always told me, sometimes when it means the most, speaking from the heart can quickly turn to speaking from the ass. So over the week, now we've heard so many stories about a man that I thought I knew. We heard so many stories that had me thinking, man, did I really know my dad? But in saying that, hearing those stories, I got to hear about a different Alan. I got to hear about Alan the drunk, the fashionista. I had the privilege of working alongside Dad in some projects, so I got to hear about Alan the youth worker, Alan the coach, the uncle, the brother, the son, the mentor, the prankster, the otarian, the husband, the Christian, and Alan the legend. My son's name is Tobias Legend, and I thought to myself last night, because all of Gloria's kids have my dad's name in it, and I told my wife, I was like, we've got Dad's name in Tobias's name too, Tobias Legend. That's my cool story. But hearing all these stories about this different Alan, today I have the privilege and absolute honor to share with you about Alan, my dad. Dad has taught me so many things. And now that I'm old enough to realize why he fathered me the way that he did. He loved me. He approved of me sometimes. And he was one whom I belonged to as a son. Those are three things that our young people, that he continued to share, not even just our young people, that us as people really want. We want to be loved. We want to belong to something, someone, and we want to be approved by. And for me, I can proudly and confidently say that my dad loved me. He approved me of me. And this man here and my mom are people that I belong to. My dad showed me and continues to be the benchmark on what it takes to be a Christian, a father, a husband, a youth worker, a notarian, and lastly, what it takes to be a man. I've shared over the week that Dad would have never been who he was or do what he does if it wasn't for my wonderful and beautiful mother. And today, Mum, I acknowledge you. You epitomize the word strength for me. So when I hear strength, when I see strength, I see you. Yes, we have lost our dad, but I honestly can't comprehend or fathom the feeling it takes to lose your soulmate, the love of your life. And Mum, I acknowledge you and honor you for showing your strength. Kia kaha.
I'm sorry.
Sorry. Uncle Wilson's been with us so long, so I gotta push that out. Everyone shared with us of how great Dad is, how good of a man he is. But honestly, he was only able to be that man because of the great God that we serve. He always pointed it back to the Lord and was a constant reminder of how great our God is in our family, in our lives. And we thank you for that, Dad. His heart was huge. His smile was contagious. His hugs brought comfort. His words was his bond. He was caring, he was loving, and embraced anyone that he encountered with. He, to me, and so many other people, are the living embodiment of what our father should be. I was truly blessed with the greatest. I have so many memories that I would like to share with you, and so many that I want to be selfish with. But there's time for that when we catch up. Dad was the greatest at one-liners. He was the king of quotes. From the movie Gladiator, the choices we make today will echo into eternity. The choices that we make today will echo into eternity. I am a product of those choices that you made, Dad. And I pray that the things that I've done today, yesterday, and tomorrow will not only glorify our God, but make my dad proud. Being Alan Vatter's son was massive. I ran from it. I hated being called Alan Vatter's son. I had midlife identity crisis when I was 14, 15. So many people knew me as Alan Vatter's son in the community, or when I get to school, oh, Miss Vatter's son. So I had two people that, when they found out who my parents were, expectations were already set. I ran from it, I dodged it, but I stand here today to embrace it. I am Alan and Alice's son. To my dad, this is just a shell. And I don't want to be selfish. So. I'm a father now, so those are my dad jokes. This is just a shell, but Dad, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for breaking your heart. I'm sorry for not picking up the phone. I'm sorry for walking past your room after training because I was tired. I'm sorry for answering back to you in front of your siblings and embarrassing you. I'm sorry. I'm sorry I wasn't there when you took your last breath. I'm so grateful that after all of this, that I get to see my dad in glory. And the only thing, honestly, team, family, friends, whānau, ainga, students, everyone in this room, the only thing that dad would want you to remember of him, nothing else. He wouldn't care about the times he shouted you fish and chips. He wouldn't care about the time he sat with you and made you feel like the only person in the room. He wouldn't care about the times that he sat with you and hugged you. The only thing that he would want you to remember is the gospel message, which is simple. And it's the same message Uncle Tony's going to share. It's the same message that if you ask any of my family what the gospel is, and I share with you today, I challenge you guys. The gospel is simple. Because reality is, when you die, there's two places you can go. Heaven or hell. Two places you can go. Heaven or hell. There's nothing else in between. Doesn't matter what religion you are. Doesn't matter if you've got a fast car or those bikes outside. Doesn't matter if you've got a degree. The gospel message is for everyone, and it's simple. That Jesus Christ died on the cross. He was buried, and 3 days later, he rose again. And if we believe in that message with all our hearts and accept him as our Lord and Savior, then we are blessed with eternal life with our Creator. Dad will always do this. Shoo-hoo! When people joined the kingdom of God. And that's the message Dad would want to leave with you guys. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. We have gone away from the hoping, like I hope to see my dad. I hope to see him when I die. To now a knowing. I know I'm going to see my dad. And for that we praise the Lord. Lastly, team, my dad was a mocker of doom. And like Keel said, they weren't bearable. There were times where I'll go to my room and cry. There were times where I was fighting behind his back when he didn't see me. There was times where his oxygen machine was on and I'll deliberately not put water in it. But then I'll put water in it after because I felt bad for him. But the one mock that I want to leave you with that Dad said to me recently, we're going at it, mocking each other, this and that. And then he goes, shut up, you're just a cloud without rain. And I was like, what? He goes, you're just a cloud without rain. I go, Dad, what does that mean? And he goes, a cloud without rain has no purpose. You're useless. I was like, damn. Ooh. But being the respectful son I am, I told him I love you. So love you so much, Dad, it hurts. It hurts. And family, thank you so much for being here. I'm going to hand it over to my sister. But from your boy, Cloudy. That's what my uncles call me now, Cloudy, when I told them their joke. From your boy, Cloudy. I want to appreciate everyone here as we celebrate the Lord. I celebrate my dad's life by praising the Lord. So thank you.
Good morning, family and friends. Thank you for being here today. My name is Gloria Joy Va'evalo, and I am the proud, proud daughter of this awesome man here. Excuse me, I'm really nervous. Caleb's the speaker of our family, he's just like dad. So please excuse my nerves. But everyone has shared about dad's community work, his ministry, and his contribution to sport. But just like Caleb, I want to share with you what Alan Va'a was like a dad. My dad was cool. He was the coolest guy. He had the coolest shoes. He wore like dicky suits, like he had a dicky shirt, dicky pants. And whenever I saw my dad out, man, I was just so proud to see him. So proud to see him. He was into his New South Wales gears. He loved the Rabbitohs, loved dressing my kids up in his jerseys. So you can see a lot of the photos on Facebook of dad dressing them up, putting on his Rabbitohs caps on the kids and putting the scarf around the kids. And man, dad was just proud. He was the coolest dad. Dad had awesome taste in music. I remember growing up, he had like boxes of cassette tapes, and he loved them so much. They were like his little treasure boxes. And how good is it to have technology today where we have my dad's Spotify playlists? He's got a whole lot of Spotify playlists, and he even did one for Easter this weekend. Dad was funny. Like Caleb said, he was a mocker. He was the worst mocker. Like, awesome man of God, but that guy will sash you. He was quick-witted, and he had comebacks for days. His way of mocking made you question your intelligence. He was the king of sarcasm. Dad was very, he knew that he would just ask you to do things. So whenever he would get sick or start to feel sick, he'll be like, Gloria, call Mark. And that's Mark Alpaco, that's our doctor. Gloria, call Mark. You have to call him. And I was like, Dad, we can't call Mark. We can't call him. He's got a schedule. You know, he's already got appointments. And he goes, I'm so sorry. I didn't know you were the receptionist at the Otara Health Centre. He was always texting, and we, like, if he knew that Logan and I were out, if boy was out, if mum was out, he would text us for drinks and snacks all the time. And if we didn't get it, we, you know, in the last couple of years, we tried to kind of be a little bit more healthier with Dad, and we said, no, Dad, we can't. I'm sorry, Dad. I'll get you some water. We're here at, and Auntie Marie sent Molly and Quella with Dad's fizzy drinks and his snacks, and or he'll send Auntie Gina. And there was one time we were out, and Dad asked, Glory, please, can you get me some Wendy's? And I was like, okay, then, Dad, because I'm his favorite, and I just do what he says. And so I went to Wendy's, and I bought him a large Coke Zero. And I thought I was really smooth, come bring it home, it's a little bit healthier, I think. I should have just got him a water, actually. And then we got home, and I gave him his food. And he goes, thank you, honey, thank you so much, I'm really hungry. And he picked up the cup and goes, why do you keep doing this to me? What a magical palate, eh? Like, he was able to tell the difference whether something had sugar or if it was diet. And my guy. My dad was a fierce protector. If anyone hurt me, Dad would say something. He would fight for me, and he would do anything he could to make sure it didn't happen again. For those of you who know our Tumal family, before we were Tumal, we were Valley Sharks. And I loved Valley. I loved it so much. I had some of my first camp experiences with Valley Sharks, and something happened in the camp at 1998, and I remember driving home in our white Pajero, driving home in 1998, January, and I remember Dad saying to Mum, honey, I think it's time we branch out. And I always thought that it was my fault that we left Valley. But Uncle Tony told me that if Dad did that to protect me, he moved from what we knew and he created Tumou. And how good is God and all the work that he's done through Tumou Ministries. Dad always told me where I belonged. He always made me feel accepted. And Dad never stopped loving me. For those of you who know our family well, you would know that I got pregnant at 16 years old. I didn't tell Mum and Dad until I was 8 months. I was going to school, I was sixth form. Logan and I were still going to school. And Auntie Marie found out, Auntie Gina and Auntie Marie found out, and they came over home on the 19th of November, 2005. I remember because it was Logan's birthday. And they knocked on the door and I opened it and I was fully pregnant, but hiding it. I was hiding everything. And I just didn't want to disappoint my dad. I didn't want to tarnish his reputation. And I wasn't ashamed of my baby, but I didn't want to disappoint Dad. So Auntie Marie and Auntie Gina came over, they knocked on the door, and I opened it and they go, "We're gonna tell Mum and Dad, okay?" I was like, so you know when you're scared and you know something's gonna happen, you start cleaning up, eh? So I started cleaning the sitting room, cleaning the kitchen, clearing the table, Mum and Dad came home. And they were like, "Gina Marie, what are you doing here?" They're like, "Alan, you guys need to sit down, we need to talk." And so they said, "Oh, okay, Gloria, you better leave." And Auntie Marie goes, "Gloria needs to stay." And I remember it because like my eyes zoomed in on her mouth, you know, like, and so we sat there and Auntie Marie and Auntie Gina, they said to Dad, "Look, Mum thought I was malnourished or something because she thought that I was sick." And they were like, what's wrong? Just tell us what's wrong. And Auntie said, "Gloria's pregnant," and I was 16. "Gloria's pregnant," and it was just quiet. And then Auntie said, "She's 8 months. She's due, and she's gonna have baby in 3 weeks." And Mum just covered her face, and Dad started crying, and I started crying because I thought I was gonna be thrown out into the streets or something. But Dad looked at me. He looked at me because I was sitting right next to him, and he hugged me. He hugged me and he said, "Gloria, I love you and I'm not ashamed of you." And that was my dad. Even though, what a rude dude, going pregnant at 16, but Dad, I'm not ashamed of you and I love you. Caleb touched on the three things that Dad always reminded us that young people need today. To feel a sense of belonging, to be loved, and to be approved of. And I just want to share a verse with you, and it's Matthew 3:17. "And suddenly, a voice came from heaven saying, 'This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.'" And that's God the Father talking about God the Son. "This is my belonging, beloved Son, love, in whom I am well pleased," approval. And that's what Dad did for me and Caleb, and I know he did it for a lot of you here as well. Dad always spent time with me. He always made me feel important and seen, and I love that he made you guys feel that way too. A lot of the testimonies coming through over the week just really encouraging Mum and I and Caleb, just with your stories, that Dad was consistent with everyone. The Dad that you guys saw was the Dad that we had at home. And he continued to pour into us as his children. Dad raised me to have a voice. I wasn't supposed to fall in the background. He valued my opinion. He taught me to speak up for those who can't speak for themselves. He taught me to be brave and courageous. If you know Dad well, you know that he loved his superheroes. Loved them. And one of my favorite pastimes with Dad is reading comics. Dad used to read comics to me, and we used to talk about it. And even last week, we were debating about who were our top 10, and I found a list. Dad really loved lists, but he wrote two lists that I want to share with you. Sorry, it's not spiritual. It's his favorite superhero teams and his top 10 favorite superheroes. So I want to share that with you. So Dad's top 10, number one, Silver Surfer, Namor, the Submariner, Mon-El, which is Superman, Colossus, Hulk, Black Bolt, Batman, Mighty Thor, Groot, and Rogue. His top 10 teams, the Defenders, X-Men, the Inhumans, Alpha Flight, Guardians of the Galaxy, Legions of Superheroes, Justice League, Excalibur, Avengers, and the Green Lantern Corps. My dad was cool, man. My dad was cool. So cool. And it wasn't until this week that I realized that I had named all five of my children after Dad. Dad's title is Malanga o Mā, and the backstory to that is, I believe it's a woman who had to pretty much do a walk of shame, Mā. So when I was pregnant, Mum and Dad didn't want that over my life. They named Jakeel Malanga Fou, a new journey. Alfredson, Simi Leonardi, he's got my dad's middle name. Marvel, I named my daughter Nat Marvel after my favorite pastime with my dad. Sayan Alan Tuller, Sayan's named after dad, he's got dad's first name. And my son Iroh, I named him after Uncle Iroh in the Avatar series, because Uncle Iroh is like the bomb uncle, and that's my dad. The dad that Uncle Iroh was to Zuko, that was my dad. And he was like that to a lot of people. When I was born, the doctor's dad said, "Glory to God, you have a beautiful baby girl." And he named me Gloria with a Y, to honor God. My full name was Gloria hyphen Joy. And I thank my dad for that, because I have so much joy, because I know where my dad is. Mum and I were with him those last couple of hours, and it was really hard. It was really hard to see Dad deteriorate that way. But Mum asked Dad, "Honey, Alan, have you completed your tasks? Have you completed your tasks?" And I know my dad finished his race. And I know full well with all my heart that as soon as Dad closed his eyes, he was instantly with our Maker, with the God that he preached about for 30 years. 2 Timothy 4, verse 7 says, "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing." Dad always kept me accountable in my walk, not just as my dad, but as brethren. Bible before breakfast, G. Have you been reading your word, honey? How's your walk going, Gloria? Have you and Logan been reading your word together? What a guy, eh? What a man. And I know that he's with the King of Kings. I know with everything that I am that he's with the Lion of the Tribe of Judah, that he's with the God of all gods, the one true God. He's with the Alpha and Omega, the God of my parents, the God my dad petitioned for you and for you two in his beautiful Otara, South Auckland. Thank you, Dad. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for accepting and loving Logan as your own. Thank you for being the greatest papa to my kids, for being fun, making us laugh, and for seeing me as your daughter. Thank you for praying for us. Thank you for being a dad to me and a father to many. Thank you for being the best example for Caleb. The best example of a man. Thank you for being the standard that I will measure all men to. One, Dad and I were having like an argument in Messenger, And this is how Dad finished it. He always finished it with the truth. And he said, Gloria, I can only say one thing. I love Jaquiel, Albie, Marvel, Sayan, Iroh, and Tobias so much that it hurts. And I mourn for my children and my nephew Tobias, because they won't know Papa Alan. They won't remember him. But there is joy in the Lord. And I'm so grateful that they have all these aunties and uncles to tell them about their papa. The champion of Otara, 274, rough, rugged, and raw. The beautiful home of the brave. Lover of good food, good music, and good company. Husband of the beautiful Alice. Big brother, father, and papa to many. Faithful servant of the Most High. I miss you forever, my guy. Wait for me at the finish line, Dad. I will see you in glory. I love you so much. Thank you for coming today.
Thanks, Glory. Hey, before Alice gets up and comes and talks, I just want to, if there's a car that's blocking the main gate. We've been asked if that person can move their car. The car's, looks like it's a white Mitsubishi, number plate HFJ899. Please, we don't want people to look at you as you're getting up to move. So if we could all bow our heads and pray. So we can allow that person with grace to move through the hall and make their way out to the car, please. But before Alan, Gloria talked about Alan's, he was the worst mocker. It reminded me of a story that I talked to our original sports camp team as they came through to pay their respects. And you know how Alan loved the South Sydney team? I'm a Bulldogs supporter. And he invited, a couple of years ago, Bulldogs played South Sydney in the final. Alan invited me to come over to his house. I thought he had invited a whole bunch of guys, but it was just me and him. And I think sometimes he invited me so he could focus his full attention on me. And the Bulldogs got a hiding. South Sydney actually ran over them. Hey, Baller, you feel my pain, Bro Marsh? And he just constantly hit me with, are you all right, bro? Are you okay, bro? Do you need a hug, bro? And he goes, oh, Caleb, can you go get Uncle some tissues? You know, and honestly, it was ripping me up inside as I sat there in his chair. And when the game was finished, I just slowly got up and he goes, also, do you want me to ring you to make sure you get home safely? But what he didn't realize is that as I walked outside his house, I stood by his car contemplating for 10 minutes would I smash his windows. But I realised it was Alice's car too, so I couldn't do that. But that's how I also was. So I want to offer the... we now have the opportunity to hear from Alan's, the love of his life, Alice.
Le aso le nei na whaia le ali'i. Tā tau te oli oli ma fia fia I ai. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Psalms 118, verse 24. Today is a day to celebrate, and commemorate and be blessed that our Lord has made and has planned and brought favor to this place right now. Let us rejoice. Let's all be of good cheer. Let's be glad in it. This has been a popular verse for Alan and I for the last 35 years. It's been a verse that we had used in our wedding anniversary invitations. It was a verse that we used on our programs because we believed in it so much. And today it's come full circle. This is the day to rejoice and be glad in it. I found it really hard to put my muli mau, my speech, together, and I thought that I'd be clever enough to start from day one. Alan died on my birthday. And you know, I remember him lying on the bed, and Gloria said, "Dad, it's Mum's birthday." And he was zoning in and out and wasn't all there. And he goes, oh, that's some. And then he went off like that. So we're going to sing happy birthday to me. No, we're not. It's not about me. I knew at that split second, that moment, he knew. And he wanted to sing that song, so I thought I'd just share it. So I decided to put my speech in kind of just like a history road. So the start of an amazing encounter and how I got to meet the very love of my life. The year is 1982. I came from the Presbyterian Church on Ferguson Road 40 years ago. And our church, our youth, held discos every Friday. And having the discos, we used to have the local other churches come and join in. And I remember the Catholic boys. Gwana is here right now. I know. Saunwo is here, come all the way from Melbourne. There's many of the friends that had journeyed with my husband in the early 80s that are here right now. And that's where it begins. We had a camp running at the Hinua Christian camp. And a group of the Catholic boys arrived at this camp late. So they made this big scene at the back coming in, and we're all sitting down looking at these boys who loved the attention. They came in late and sat at the back. We played this game where our leader said, "We've got all the names of everybody in here, so we want you to draw out a name, and that person is going to be your secret friend for the whole weekend. And I want you to make that person feel special. I want you to do something out of your comfort zone without them knowing who you were." So, you know, I was so excited. The girls were getting their names, pulling it out. So I pulled mine out and I looked at my name and I didn't know who this person was. And I went, "Alan V? Who the heck is Alan V?" So I didn't know. I was just more excited knowing that someone's going to have me, and I wonder if it's so-and-so and so-and-so. So right through the weekend, on the first night when we had dinner, I lined up with the girls, and someone came up to me and said, "Oh, you're okay, Alice. Your secret friend's already got your food. You can just go sit down." And I thought, oh my gosh, okay, you know. So I went down, sat down, I was looking at my friends, and I was just kind of scanning around to see if one of the boys would look at me, and I said, "I wonder if it's you." I was so blessed, and even more blessed, that when I went to my cabin, there were little daisies, forget-me-nots, that were left on my pillow. No joke, honestly. I go, oh my gosh, who is this guy? I was just So indeed, I was so excited. So as the weekend went by, came back again to my cabin, and on my bed, I found a poem that goes like this. Roses are red, violets are blue. I am so blessed that I have you. I held it to my heart. So excited. I go, oh my gosh, is it Fiji? Is it so-and-so? Oh my goodness. I'm sorry, I just leaked out the name. Sorry about that. And I couldn't wait for Sunday. Well, meanwhile, this Alan V that I was trying to check out, yeah, I saw him. He was loud. You know, he loves singing jingles from TV commercials, going around with everyone and harmonizing and doing this and that. Then he came up to me with the two of the other guys and sang this big thing, you know, the big pen. And I'll go, oh, yeah, that's really cool, you know. You know, but he just, he was like, people were just drawn to him. He was funny, you know, and I was glad he was having a good time. But, yeah, no, I wasn't going to do flowers. I wasn't going to do poems or anything like that. I was just excited to know that someone out there made me feel special. Well, Sunday came, and I couldn't wait. So I got myself ready, packed my bags like we were all getting ready to go. And then our leader said, okay, all the boys come up in the front. Come up in the front and sit down. And girls, you have 5 minutes. 5 minutes to tell Anoa and talk with your secret friend. So all of them sat down, and I see Alan right up in the front. I said, oh, yeah, okay, just wait. I just wait. I just hang about. And the boys went, and Alan would look at them. Oh, yeah, Alan's got Enid. Oh, yeah, so-and-so. Oh, sorry, not Alan. So-and-so has Christine Papali'i. Oh, yeah, so-and-so. But he was thumbs up like this, you know, still waiting for his secret friend. One more minute, one more minute. And I thought, gee, I think I'll go in the last 30 seconds. You know, so I was just panning, going up like this. And then he looks around. I went, coming, coming. So I went up to him and I went, hi, Alan. And he turned around and his jaw dropped. It absolutely dropped. He looked at me and he said, oh, my goodness. Alice, I am so happy to know that you had me. I went, oh, yeah, did you enjoy camp? Did you so-and-so? And I see you. You really had a good time. And so forget, yeah, I'm just so rapt to know that, you know, you had me. And I said, yeah. That's cool. I'm glad you enjoyed camp. You know, just a few more minutes and then we have to go. Time. Girls, you can sit down. Boys, please go to your secret friend. And here's me looking around over here, wondering who it was. I said, Alan, you could go now. And you know what he said to me? Roses are red. And I said, no. But no. Violets are not blue. And the rest is history. We got married in 1987, and at that time, Otahuhu College was the biggest hall. We had over 400 people at the wedding. We just left control with our parents to do what they had to do as being the eldest daughter, the eldest son from the Va'a and the So'e family. In 1988, Gloria Joy was born, the love of our life. All glory to God. 1992. A pelican flew from the sky. And dropped the baby down my leg. 1992, Caleb was actually a miracle baby. Because I thought during the time I was carrying him, I had lost him. And praise the Lord, our GP, Mark Arbuckle, found the the beating heart. So I knew without any shadow of a doubt, we are going to expect a beautiful bonny boy. Caleb Benjamin Faifeesevaa was born. And this is where our ministry begins. We formed a group called The Messengers, and I had friends from the PIC Church, Catholic Church, combined together, and we did gospel singing. We loved heritage singers. We loved singing together. We loved going around places and doing outreach and singing. That's where we felt the Spirit of the Lord fall afresh on us. There were leaders in our group, and this is the start. This was only just the beginning. In 1985, I joined Youth for Christ, and later on, Alan took over as I fell pregnant during that time and carried on full ministry from there, which branched out to Heartbeat City Ministries. There are people here right now that have come to the club rooms during this week, that have come home, that remember Youth for Christ, Heartbeat City Ministry, that my people right now from Tumau, from Tumau up, they did not know what Alan and I had been doing beforehand. In Heartbeat City Ministry, we're involved in outreaches. We traveled all over the North Island with a group called, there were four groups, four teams. We were outreach team three. That was me and Alan, my sister Susie, and not sure who it was, Robert. We were all split. The messengers were split. They put the messengers amongst the four teams and said there was messengers no more. We then had to teach kapa haka. We had to do creative dance. We had to do spectators and all spectaculars, all that sort of stuff put together, and traveled around spreading the gospel. I thoroughly enjoyed it. My mom thought, oh my gosh, Gloria was only a baby, and she didn't like the fact that we were going around like gypsies. So that was Heartbeat City Ministries. We got involved in Ngātō discipleship. You know who you are. You came and you visited us at home. Praise and worship, baptism and all that was just a real joy for Alan and I. Rallies at Otahuhu College. Hundreds and hundreds of young people came and were exposed to the Word of God through dance, through plays, through testimonies, through awesome speakers. And it was just totally amazing and electric during that era. Super Tops, thousands of people turned up at Super Top, where we had rallies that were open beyond and extended beyond South Auckland. I attended there. We were involved in youth at risk programs for young teenagers. Yesterday, I got to meet the originals, a team of young men that Alan had a vision to see come play rugby league. They all come from different walks of life, but they all had the skill of coming together to play rugby league. I shared with them yesterday, someone mentioned about, thank you, Alice. We knew finance during that time was really tight. And I thought back, and I said, oh my gosh, I remember the originals during Light Festival when they traveled down to Rotorua as a team. I remember the Parakai camp that we had up north where hundreds of people came, and they came as well. And then I said to Alan, hey, do you still have the 2,000 shares from Fisher and Paykel in the account? And I go, oh, about that. He cashed it in. At that time, you know, we weren't talking because I had hope that, yeah, let's get this for the house. Let's buy this for Gloria. Let's get this and that and this. It didn't happen. However, I know seeds were planted during that time. We didn't get to see the boys 10, 20, 30, 40 years later. They have children of their own. But they came yesterday to pay respect to Alan, and it brought me back to now I know. Now I get it, Alan. I get it. In 1990, we represented and played for Valley Sharks. And it was a sports group that we played out in Matamata, Totara Springs with Liz and Pessa Wilson. And we brought a handful of South Auckland students to come and play together with this team that was from the west side. As the years went by, we thought we'd branch out more so that we could open our tent pegs and invite more of our South Auckland young people to the sports camp. And this is where Te Mau started. And it still is today. 23 years later, hundreds of young people have come and heard the word. They thought, oh yeah, put me down for the b-ball game. Hey, I do indoor bowls and I do petonk. They thought it was all about the sports, but there was a catch in it. There were booster sessions where the gospel was shared. Real subtle, but then at the end of the camps, we go under one big tree at the back of Totara Springs, and Alan gives them the other opportunity to come to know the Lord. Not Alan Va'a, not Te Mau, but to know the Lord. We may just have one person come up, praise the Lord. Or we may not have any, but the seeds were planted. And all we had to do was step back and let God do the rest. And I tell you that what? God did work in their lives. Don't know how, but God did. 1997, Liz and Pessa gave us an application to apply for a Habitat home because we were living in Israel Ave in the community house upstairs for 7 years. For 7 years we were up. I loved it because the sun came right around from the kitchen right around to the end of my room. I loved it. I knew what type of day it was going to be from being second floor, and you can see and scanned the whole of Auckland. I loved it. Caleb and then thought the house was kind of possessed, but it wasn't really. It wasn't haunted. I really enjoyed that. We were there 7 years. So we qualified out of 250 people for a Habitat home. Had to read up on it and I said, okay, we got the Habitat home, what next? We actually had to build it. We had to build our home. And guess what? Hands up those who built their home in the middle of Aotea Square. Nobody, you know what? We got to build our house in Aotea Square, and it took 3 days. 3 days. We had people from the apartments that saw what was going on, and they came down, donate this plant to the family that's down there and so forth and so forth. We got the university people, a handful of them that want to come in and help support and build your house. And you know, not long before that, this herd of people started coming up from Queen Street. No joke. We were wondering, oh my gosh, what's happening? Is there a riot? It was the All Blacks. They all came to meet in the middle of Aotea Square, and they surrounded our house, not to help out with the house, but they surrounded to celebrate the All Blacks during that time. It was magical. I tell you, it was like favor that I cannot explain. We got a 3-bedroom Habitat home. They picked it up and they brought it down to Otara, the promised land. over here, just up the top, and we've been in it now for 25 years. Interest-free. Who does that? Who does that? In 2005, we were invited, Alan and I, to represent Habitat at the Governor's House. The Governor's House. I said to Alan, oh, look, we got this invitation. We have to represent Habitat for Humanity, and we get to visit the Queen of England. And I thought, oh, wow, what a good opportunity. But, you know, we knew she wouldn't come near us. I mean, she had her route. So we thought we'd just kind of sneak at the back and go to the gazebo where all the food was. And, you know, we sit there, we saw the dignitaries walking past over here, and we're eating this, yes, I'll have some of that. And we were just cracking up at the back. And then all of a sudden, like a wave, the crowd parted. It parted. It parted like coming towards me. I said, oh, Alan, something's happening. So we all kind of stood on the side, wiped our mouth, and here comes the Queen. She's walking right across over here. I'm not making this up. Honestly, we weren't allowed to bring cameras at that time. She came right up and she stopped at me, and she's such a short person, but she had striking blue eyes and powdered skin. She looked at me and she goes, hello. And then we had to curtsy, like, you know, like I turned around and I said, Alan. At the same time, the Duke of Edinburgh was talking with Alan, because he saw his necklace that he was wearing, MacGyver necklace, and he said to Alan, oh, Gili Kitty, and Alan goes, yes. Who does that? It's amazing. We get to hold hands and meet the Queen of England and the Duke of Edinburgh. What an awesome opportunity. 2006, we come back from the originals anniversary, 2005. And it was 2:30 in the morning when we got home. We sat down, stopped at the petrol station, got some jelly tips. We sat down and we reclined and watched telly. And then all of a sudden, you heard the smashing of metal and glass outside. Now, we're up the top of our driveway. We're the only house up the top. And I hear it. And I said to Alan, what's that noise? And he goes, Alice, come back. You know, but, you know, no fear in me. I just go out, running in my ear, lover, in my T-shirt, standing on the top of the driveway, and all I could see, these two girls running across, crying, he's dead. I went, oh my gosh. So I run down, and Alan's trying to dial to call the police, because we did not know what the noise was. Get down the bottom, and you see two bodies lying down at the end of our street. So I run to the first one, and he was conscious, he was breathing, looked around, he was okay, put him in a recovery position. Then I went around on the other side, and here was one guy lying down on the ground. His head was hit with a Jim Beam bottle, so the bottle of the neck was lying down the bottom, and his head was like in a V shape, flipped forward. Grabbed his head, put my hand and compressed it, knelt down beside him. It's okay. It's okay. Alan comes down. He goes, Fia Boko, my gosh, you've got to look and assess the area before you come and do what you do, you know. So he's coming down huffing and puffing, and then an old man from across the road comes out with a broomstick, and we're underneath the only lit lamp in the street. Right in the middle. Nobody else came out. Nobody else. One of our friends later came out when he got everything ready in the house to make sure they were safe before he came out. And he stood with Alan and the old man. And then you hear the rumbling of chains, clinking like this. And I turn down kneeling, and I look around, and I look at the park, and all you could see is a silhouette of footsteps coming towards you. And Alan's going, Jesus, Jesus. Oh my, Jesus, Jesus. You know, and the old man's, yeah, come on. Come on, you know, with this broomstick. You know, and I'm kneeling over the guy, and I know he's just trying to get air into his system. And I bent over and I said, it's okay. I got you. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. Shh. Jesus loves you. It's okay. The gang of these people, these young people, came and stood around the outside of the lights. And I could just see their feet. I could see the chains dangling. But I still held on to the boy in front of me. I said, hey, what you doing, you B-I-T-C-H? And my husband is going, honey, honey, stand firm. No, no, calm down, boys. You know, calm down, you know. Come on, come on, you know. And you know what? All of a sudden you hear, is that you, Mrs. Va? I couldn't see to this day who it was. I said, no, don't touch. She's okay. She's all good. Mr. and Mrs. Va, they're fine. They're fine. And then they slowly walked out of the light and went somewhere else. The ambulance turned up and assessed the situation and said, this boy's not going to make it. He's not going to make it. The following day, they cordoned off and they blocked our street off for about a couple of days. Then we found out that the gang went further down and murdered someone down the road. There was a connection to what they were doing. I didn't find out till about 6 months later. There was a knock on the door. I said, Alan, answer the door. You answer the door. He answered the door eventually and stood a tall boy that blocked out the light in our doorway. Yeah, yeah, Mrs. Vutter's here, Mrs. Vutter's here. And he goes, honey, there's someone here to see you. I walked out and I go, hi, son. Are you okay? You one of my students? He goes, no. I come to say thank you. Do I know you? What year are you? Where are you from? And he says, turns around the other way, and I see a big scar on his head. I'm Ernest. I was the one that you spoke to when things happened during the riot. I heard you say, Jesus. I heard you say that. And I just want to come and say thank you. Thank you. Isn't God good? Our God is so good. I just cannot fathom. I cannot do my Moli Mau without highlighting those aspects of things, that events that happened in my husband and my family's life. God had our back. He got our back. I don't know what would have happened. We could have died. I don't know. This was the start. That incident became the start of 274 Youth Corps that was supported under Cross Power. God's favor was on 274 and Cross Power. They had Helen Clark come because they needed young people and young men to help with teenagers and youth, such as what happened on that evening. And they gave them $2 million to help and fund for this program. Isn't God good? I'm just absolutely overwhelmed. There's so many more that I could talk on about, but I want to highlight this week, during the time we've had people from all walks of life that have been special, that have said that Alan had impacted in their lives. It was the most busiest week that I've ever had to go through in my life. I have heard people from as far as five decades back come and share their story, their talanoa about the memories of me and Alan's journey. And like a cup gathering whatever, it was just absolutely overflowing. I was just absolutely drained with happiness and joy because I just couldn't comprehend the favor that God had implanted in each of these people that have full circle come around to say and tribute to my husband. I tried with every single group that came and shared to glean one word from each of the group that they shared about my husband. And here are some of the words. Your husband's God-fearing. He's a man of integrity. He's a gentleman. He's a visionary. He's a man of great legacy, a community man, a role model, an encourager. And he's a family man, a great dad, a gentle bear, great hugger. He was funny. He was humble, man with a passion for the community. He was kind. He made you feel like you belonged. He was a strategist, made you feel loved, a great listener, a man of prayer, a great leader, a man of authority, man of reason, man that made you feel special. He was my husband, my children's father, a son, a brother, an uncle, a true leader, and an awesome man. This is what I thought with all those words sums up my husband. Philippians 2 verse 3 says, do nothing from selfish ambition or empty arrogance, but with humility of heart, regard one another as more important than yourself. And that's my husband. That's my husband. And I just totally thank the Lord. I know without any shadow of a doubt, I know where my husband is. And I may not see him around. He's hard to miss because you know this is his spot here. This is where Alan sits, and here's me running around saving the world, trying to get a good strong chair, go get his cane and go get his water, go get this and go get this, just running ping, 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 ping. I became quite good at that, as a matter of fact, because I didn't mind doing that for my husband. My cup runneth over, my heart overflows. I am truly humbled and grateful for hearing the stories and your heart and memories shared. This week we honor and celebrate the life of Alan and how God works in mysterious ways. If it wasn't for God, people would be chasing the wind. And like chasing the wind, you can't get it. Empty hand, it gets lost. Be of good cheer. This is an awesome day God has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Alan's favorite song and scripture. I'm going to ask the Phileo boys to come forward. And anyone who knows I'm a friend of God, you come forward because this is Alan's favorite song. Who am I that you, Lord, are mindful of me? That you hear me when I call? Is it true that you are thinking of me? It's amazing. Psalms 8 verse 4. I am a friend of God. Alan is with God. Thank you, people.
Thank you, Alice, for sharing your journey with Henry, journey with Alan. So your journey with Alan, and that's only part of it. You didn't actually get through all the things that you and the brother went, things that you did in your journey. And before I have Tony come up, and I remember part of their journey. I remember the Habitat House, and I remember all the boys coming in and people coming in to help. And I remember your house being at Aotea Square. So it was wonderful times. Thank you for that. So I'm going to have our brother Tony. Taylor.
Yeah, I remember going to help out build the house at Aotea Square. Turned up, I'd worked late, and I crawled under the house to do something and fell asleep. And people looked underneath it, but Alan's falling asleep underneath the house. So I didn't get to do any work, but privileged to be there. Greetings in the name, the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. First of all, I'd like to thank you all for coming out to support, to give tribute, but mostly to celebrate the life of our dear brother Alan. Thank you for those who posted on social media your stories, your testimonies about how Alan had impacted your lives. It was just been amazing reading some of those posts, and a real blessing to read the posts of those who have said that because of the encounter with Alan, they have become believers in Jesus Christ. So praise the Lord for that. I would also like to thank Alice and Gloria and Caleb for sharing Alan with the rest of us. I'm not sure how much say you had in that, but thank you that you allowed Alan to be the social butterfly that he was. You know, when years ago, when we were younger, I would rock up to Alan and Alice's house after dinner time, and we would spend hours, me and Alan would spend hours talking, just bouncing things off each other, and some of it was league, but most of it was about our faith, questions about our faith. And, you know, I would spend hours talking with one another, and I would leave around about 1 o'clock and sometimes 2 o'clock in the morning from his house. But little did I know that in the bedroom, Alice was cussing me out. She couldn't wait till I left their house. And the simple reason being is that Alan gave so much of his time to the community and to other people that she just wanted time. For her and the kids with her husband. And this idiot rocks up 2 or 3 times a week and taking up more of their time. And I'm sure Alice was swearing under her breath every time she heard my name. But Alice and I are good now. Hey, Ellie, we're all good now. Leaves for healing too, eh? I remember I gave that bush with all the leaves on it so that for your healing. Yeah. So praise God for that. But I want to honor Alice and Gloria and Caleb for sharing their father with all of us and her husband. But all that Alan has accomplished and all the accolades and the awards that he's won, none of it would have been possible without your support. You know, especially Alice, who loved him, who, you know, who cheered him on in his victories, who encouraged him when in his failures, who told him off when he was wrong, who nursed him back to health when he was sick. Thank you, Alice, who loved him as a faithful wife. And so I give you honor. I honor you, Alice, and Gloria and Caleb, and the family, for allowing the rest of us to have time with Alan. As you all know, Alan was a beloved social worker and community leader, not only in Ōtara but in South Auckland. But everything that he has accomplished, and he's accomplished a lot in his life, everything that he has accomplished was born out of his faith in Christ Jesus. Everything. It was born out of his faith in the God of the Bible, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of Israel, the God of the nations, the God of our salvation, and the God of Alan Va'a. Everything he did was born out of his love for God. For when you love God, you can't help but love other people. And that's the legacy that Alan leaves with us. He served and loved other people because of his service and love for his God. You know, apart from Alan's public persona as this legend of youth and social work and community in the community, there were so many other things that Alan was involved in outside of that. Things that were just as impactful, if not more so, than his community work. And I just want to share a few of those things. You know, for many of us Christians back in the late 80s, Alan was our first Bible study teacher. And he used to run Ngātua Bible studies out of his parents' garage in Luke Place. And there were a number of us young people back then that Alan would teach the Word of God with. And I remember after one Bible study, Alan laid this challenge for all of us. And he challenged us that if every friend or person that you know that followed Christ stopped following the Lord, would you still carry on following the Lord? Would you still carry on in your relationship with God? And that challenge has stayed with me all my life. And I remember when he said that, and I said, yes, yes, I would. You know, Alan and Alice have served together in ministry for a long time. First, they served together in Youth for Christ South Auckland, and then later on in Heartbeat City Ministries, where they led one of those four outreach teams that traversed the length and breadth of the North Island, doing rallies and sharing the gospel message. Alan also started packed down prayer meetings. Early hours of Saturday morning, 6 o'clock in the morning, would meet to pray. And that was born out of Alan taking time to spend with one of our other dear brothers to encourage him in his walk and to pray with him. And out of that was born the packed down prayer meeting, where we packed down to pray for our family and our friends and for our communities. Then, you know, Alan and Alice were with Valley Sharks, but then they decided to leave there to form another team to bring more young people from South Auckland to the sports camp at Maramara, where they would play the sports that they loved, but most importantly for us, that they would hear the gospel message of Jesus Christ. Whether they heard it from the preacher at camp or not, they would always hear it from us. And like Alan said, Alan would sit at the end of camp after prize giving. Alan would sit under that tree where we were encamped, and he would gather the team around him, and that's when Alan or David or Caleb or myself will get to share the gospel with our team one more time before we dispersed, because we are not guaranteed tomorrow. We don't know if we're going to see them again, and we wanted to make sure they understood that salvation is through Christ Jesus alone. You know, and out of that first year of 2 Mile Sports Team, some of the boys asked Alan to start a Bible study to help them grow in their faith. They all belonged to different churches, but they weren't growing. And so Alan started a Bible study, and we called it Sweet and Sour, because that's one of our favorite foods. And sometimes life is sweet and sometimes it's sour. And then we shortened it down to SAS Bible Studies. And a few years on from that, Alan and Alice left the Sanctuary Church to start a new local church to cater or to try and have a place for those in our sports team that were falling through the cracks at church. You know, they'd become believers, but they weren't growing in their own churches, and they'd eventually stopped going. And so they left with Marie and David to start this new local church and called the Waterhole. And Alan and David Singh and myself were privileged to be the elders of that church. You know, Alan, he was much more than just the legend of social and community work in Otara and South Auckland. You know, he did many more other things. He was so many more other things that he was involved in, apart from the things that I have mentioned. You know, Alan had his fingers in all the pies, figuratively and literally. That's why he's such a big man. But he knew, you know, whenever Alan encountered people, he was not only concerned about their well-being in this life, he had a deeper concern for their well-being for eternity, where they would spend eternity. Because Alan knew there are only two places you can go when you pass from this life. There's either eternal life with God, or there is eternal damnation ultimately in the lake of fire. You cannot earn salvation. Just because you've been to church every Sunday of your life doesn't make you a Christian. Just because you've done good works, you think you're a good person, doesn't make you a Christian. You cannot earn salvation. And there is no such place. The Bible does not teach a place called purgatory. There's only life and there's only death. Salvation is a free gift of God that he offers to every one of you today and every day while you have breath. There is a standard for getting into heaven. The standard that God has is perfection. And no human being in the history of the world has been able to meet that standard, apart from Christ Jesus himself. And so in John 3, none of us can meet that standard of perfection. And Romans 3:23 tells us that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All of us have sinned and fall short of God's standard of perfection. King David in Psalm 51:5 says, in iniquity was I brought forth, and in sin did my mother conceive me. None of us are free from sin. The consequence of sin is stated in Romans 6:23. The wages of sin is death. Eternal death in the lake of fire. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. Please do not be fooled. Do not be misinformed. God is just and righteous, and he will judge every sin. But his love for us, God made sure that there was a way out from that judgment and that sin. And in John 3:16 it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whomever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. God, knowing that none of us could meet his perfect standard, provided a way out for us. So he sent his Son, who became flesh in the person of Jesus Christ, who lived a sinless life, who was crucified on the cross on our behalf and in our place, who was buried, and on the third day he rose again, and whomever believes in his death, burial, and resurrection shall not perish and in everlasting death, but shall have eternal life in Christ Jesus. In John 14:6, Jesus said that I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. No one comes to the Father except by me. There is no other person, there is no other works you can do, there is no other way to heaven except through Christ Jesus. And if you would put your trust and your faith in his death, burial, and resurrection, you too can have the glory, the glorious joy of what Alan is experiencing now. And that's to be face to face with the living God, with his King, his Master, his Lord, Jesus. John 3:18 says, he who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son. In John 3:36, the last verse of that chapter says, he who believes in the Son has everlasting life, and he who does not believe the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. If you have not received Christ, then you are condemned already. If you have not received Christ, then the wrath of God abides on you now. And the only way to escape the righteous judgment of God is to put your faith and your trust in his death, the death, burial, and resurrection of his Son, Jesus. That is the only way you can escape the righteous judgment of God for our sins. So family and friend, God puts before you eternal life or eternal death, eternal light or eternal darkness. The choice is yours. And I know that Alan Mauso and the family would urge me and plead with you, to extol you, to beg you to receive Christ as your Lord and Savior today. The opportunity is with you while you still have breath, but when that breath is gone, it's too late. You know, we often say at funerals, you know, he's in a better place or they're in a better place. It's only true for those who are in Christ Jesus. Only those in Christ Jesus are in a better place. The rest await damnation in the lake of fire. And so I plead with you, listen to this message today and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. You cannot earn salvation. I close by saying that Alan has lived a full life. The Bible teaches that the death of believers is by God's design. So Alan hasn't gone too early. He's gone at the perfect time that God has appointed for him to go. And now we can say that Alan, he has fought the good fight, he has finished his race, and now he's heard these wonderful words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." And for those of you who are believers, I just want to encourage you to continue to pray for Alice and Gloria and Caleb and the family, and also for the siblings, Gina, Junior, Marie, because it's after the busyness is gone and after all the hustle of this funeral is finished and it's the quiet time, that's when things get difficult. So please continue to pray for the families. Have time with our Lord. The Lord bless us all.
Bless you, Tony. Thank you. Can I get Tia, the also Tia, to come up and lead us in the last song? Ellen of the song.
we're here to celebrate. This is one of his many anthems. For those at 2,000 over, we know this is the anthem. You're going to hit it, yeah? Now we're going to say, Otara, South Auckland, West Auckland, Central, where we are all over the world, we're going to hit this together, family. May the heavens rejoice as they go, Chee-hoo! 1, 2, 3. Listen. All right, people, let's go. Clap your hands now. Listen. Yesterday, I meant sad to be sad. How can you smile when the world's crumbling down? I said, here's my secret, and I want you to try. Now take a look around, and I'll see what I'm all about. I said, hold on. I said, change is coming. Hold on. Don't worry about it. Hold on. I said, you can make it. Hold on. Everything will be all right. Some people like to worry. Some people like to hide. Some people like to run away from the pain inside. Now what's your business? Do whatever you want to do. But if it don't work out, say here's what you want to do. I said, hold on. I said, change is coming.
Change is coming.
I said, hold on.
Hold on.
Don't worry about it. Sons and daughters coming back to community to give back. Whatever they have, he will be at the back and he will say, welcome home, son. Welcome home, boy. Welcome home to the promised land. We will continue to sing. We will continue to sing this message. In whatever way, whatever vehicle, is always pointing to the cross. The battle is not on me. He's already called you family. He's already given you his gifts. The battle now falls on your hands. What are you going to do? It has to be above you. Because your good is not good enough. So go back to the source. Go back to the one who first loved you. Jesus Christ. Alpha and Omega, the Prince of Peace. Anything for you. Anything. We love you.
Tai Lava Tia. Tia was one of Alan's sons. Very close to Alan mentored Tia and many, many other of the boys that came through Tia's generation. So thank you, Tia. Okay, family, we've come to the end of the service and just want to thank you again for your patience and for coming and showing your love for our family. I'm just so blessed to see our Mateus here, our dad I've led Alan in, and they are close brothers to Alan. Some of them are direct family blood, but others have come to be here and participate, but also to honour Alan in this way. So, I love it, guys. But just to let you know what's happening from here, family. From here, we're actually going to you can take your time making your way over to the burial site. Alan will be buried at Manukau Memorial Gardens at 1 o'clock. From here, Alan will be taken on a ride around his beloved Otara, led by led around by these. I want to thank the brothers that have come and have come to ride before Alan and lead him through the hood and that Alan loves so much. So that's what's going to happen. They're going to take Alan through his through Otara, and they'll meet us at the cemetery at 1 p.m. But what we do ask, family, we're not going to have the normal anger. There is no anger at a hall and that after. What we're asking that if people would love to spend the afternoon with us, Alan's kids, Gloria and Caleb, and his beautiful wife, Alice, we will have food available at the cemetery. Bring your picnic chairs. Come we've seen so many times, and Gloria shared her heart about that, is that sometimes we've been to funerals and we've had to rush back to the hall, yet they haven't had time to actually sit and grieve. But we have an opportunity today that if you would love to go home, pick up your picnic chairs if you would like, and come and spend the afternoon at the cemetery if that's what you want to do. But we will have food available that we will be able to distribute to everyone if you come at that way. Okay, so it's the plot is where the green flag is, two streets on the left, the second street on the left as you go in. So the Lord bless you, and the Lord have shine his face upon you as we leave from this place. But I'll quickly close us off in prayer, and then that's us, eh? Father, we just thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness to us. We thank you, Lord, that we've been able to celebrate Alan, but we've also been able to declare your goodness and your faithfulness to this man. And in everything that we do, we've been able to hopefully point people to you. So Lord, at the end of the day, you are sovereign, you are God Almighty, and we just want to honour you and bless you and declare your goodness on this day. So Lord, we pray, Father God, as we travel from this place, that you would give us traveling mercies, that you would bless everybody that's been in attendance today, and those that are tuned in online, that you would bless them too. And we give and commit all these things into your hands, the most precious hands. In the name of Jesus we pray, and everybody said amen.
Whiskey, of course.
Watch it.